Hello, and welcome to part 3 of our Research 101 series. In the previous modules, we've discussed how to refine a research topic into a research question, and the different types of information out there and how you can use it for research. In this module, we're going to cover how to find information using library and non-library resources. To do this, we're going to discuss where to look for the different types of information and demonstrate some basic search techniques and tools that will work in a variety of different databases or repositories. Before you ever start querying a database, it's important to identify the type of information you're looking for. The type of information you're looking for will determine the best places to search for it. For example, suppose you're in the market for a new mountain bike. Would a car dealership be a good place to go looking for it? Of course not. A car dealership may boast a massive selection, but it will be a massive selection of cars, not bicycles. You'd be far better off going to a sporting goods store or a shop that specializes in bicycles. In this same sense, some search tools are better than others for finding specific types of information. If you're looking for books, OneSearch, our library catalog and search engine, is going to be your best bet. Using this tool, you can find books not only in our collection here at Cal Poly Pomona, but across all 23 campuses in the Cal State system. If you're looking for peer-reviewed articles, you can also search for them in OneSearch, but depending on the topic, a better bet might be to seek out a subject-specific database. This is a database that only contains articles from journals in a specific discipline or group of disciplines, like psychology. Good examples of subject-specific databases include PsycINFO, Sociological Abstracts, or Compendix. On the other hand, if your research touches on a couple of different disciplines, you might want a general database, like JSTOR or Academic Search Premier. These databases contain articles from journals in a wide variety of disciplines and may give better coverage when you're researching a topic that isn't easily pigeonholed into a single discipline. Now, that's great if you're looking for peer-reviewed articles, but what about news articles? The library actually has some excellent news databases with historical coverage of major papers, including the New York Times and the Los Angeles Times. These sources can help provide you with primary source materials on news events that occurred in the past few decades. If you need coverage of current events or breaking news, however, you might be better off going to the websites of reputable news sources and gathering your materials there, as these will be the most up-to-date sources of breaking news. Finally, if you're looking for specific sources of data, it really depends. The library has access to some databases, including Mergent, Hoover's, and RAND, which provide access to data sets and statistics. However, some of the richest data sources available to you aren't in the library, but are rather provided by government. The federal government, through sites like census.data.gov and data.gov, can provide you with data sets on everything from population and demographics to power usage and unemployment rates. State and local governments can be useful sources of geospatial data sets for GIS projects as well. So before you just plunge into the databases expecting them to provide you with everything you might be looking for, figure out the kind of information you want, and then pick the best tool for finding it. You'll have a much better chance of finding what you want if you're looking for it in the right place. Once you've determined where you're going to look for information, the next step is to figure out how you're going to query that database or repository. Now, there are a lot of different kinds of databases, search engines, and repositories out there, and they can be as different from one another as JSTOR is from Google. So I'm not going to show you how to use each and every type of database you might run into out there, as there's just not enough time to do it, or enough caffeine out there to keep you awake long enough to see it all. So instead, we're going to cover some basic strategies and tools that can help you search just about anywhere. To start out with, let's understand something about how a database performs a search. When you pump search terms into a database, the database scans its contents for matches to the words you plug into it. Sometimes it only searches specific fields, like the title or the abstract. Other times, it can search the full text of the article along with all the descriptive data. In any case, the database has been programmed to ignore certain words and focus only on certain keywords to perform its search. For example, if a database were going to order a coffee, it wouldn't walk up to the counter and say, "I'd like an iced coffee, size Trinta, with 2 packets of stevia and half and half." Instead, it would probably bark something along the lines of, "Iced coffee, Trinta, 2 stevias, half and half." If that in any way sounds familiar to you, you've probably worked at a Starbucks at some time in your life. What you see there is the information of the order boiled down to its barest essentials. The nice connecting words that we use in polite conversation have all been removed, and only certain words, keywords, identified by the computer as the ones that carry the most meaning in that query, are the only ones that actually get communicated. In much the same way, when you query a database, it's designed to ignore all but the keywords in your query. Now, when choosing keywords for a search, we need to understand something about specificity. To do this, let's use an example you're all probably familiar with. You've probably all bought something from Amazon in the past, and Amazon is a database. The digital objects contained in Amazon are the pages with various types of items you're buying. So let's say you wanted to buy some shoes from Amazon. Would you just type the word shoes into the search box? Of course not. You'd be inundated with results, most of which would be useless. In order to find the shoes you want, you need to use search terms that are specific, such as the type, the brand, the color, etc. What's true for shopping on Amazon is equally true for searching for sources on a database. You need to use keywords that are specific enough to get a set of search results that work for your topic. For example, let's say we use this research question we talked about in part one. What regions of the United States are experiencing population growth, and what are the factors contributing to it? A database is only going to see the following words: regions, United States, population, growth, factors, contributing. And it might even ignore factors and contributing. So how does this help you? Well, instead of trying to write your research query word for word in a search box, you can just type in the keywords. This eliminates the possibility of confusing the database with needless clutter and gets to the point of your argument. However, if you're going to do this, you should also be aware of the fact that the words you want looked for together, like United States, population growth, and so forth, are currently separated. So the database will look up every instance of United, every instance of States, and every instance of United States, giving you the possibility of having a lot of results that have nothing to do with what you're interested in. So how do you tell the database that you want it to always look for certain words in certain combinations? You use quotation marks. By grouping certain words together with quotation marks, you're telling the database that you only want results where those two words are found together in that exact order. So it will now only look for United States, population growth, or contributing factors, and not the isolated words that make up those phrases. So let's say you put in your keywords and you only get a couple of results, or even worse, you get nothing. Bummer. Now what? Well, let's go back and look at our keywords. Are these the only words we can use to describe these ideas? Probably not. For example, instead of regions, we could be much more specific and use terms like counties or cities, or we could get much broader and use a term like areas. The same could be said for most of our keywords. These different words that mean the same thing or close to the same thing are what we call synonyms, and they provide us with a much larger pool of keywords from which we can draw to try and find the results in our database. So in doing a keyword search, always remember to never do just one search with a single set of keywords. Using synonyms and different combinations of words will give you different and sometimes better results than your original search. Keywords, however, are only one tool we can use to help a database know what we're looking for. Let's look at another powerful tool you can use in your searching: Boolean operators. Boolean operators are special words that tell a database how keywords should relate to one another in that search. While there are more Boolean operators than just the three we're going to discuss, these are the ones you're more likely to come across in your database searching. The most commonly used Boolean operator is AND. AND tells the database that you only want results where the two search terms linked by this operator both appear. As AND tends to severely cut down on the number of results you get, because they must have both terms, it's a good tool to narrow your results. So in the case demonstrated on the screen, using AND means you want both Cal Poly and Pomona together, which will only provide you with the results for our campus and not SLO or Humboldt. The next most commonly used Boolean operator is OR. OR tells the database that you're flexible about what results you get. You want results containing Cal Poly, results containing Pomona, and results containing Cal Poly Pomona. If you get results containing slow or humbled, it's no big deal. Using OR, therefore, tends to greatly expand your results. Why would you want to do that? Well, in some cases, you may have a variety of terms, such as treatment, intervention, and therapy, that are all used to describe the same thing in the literature. OR allows you to look for all three at the same time, treatment, OR intervention, OR therapy, rather than having to do three separate searches. It can save you some time. On the other hand, OR can blow up your search results, so using the OR operator may provide you with too many results to be manageable, so use it carefully. The last Boolean operator we're going to talk about is NOT. We don't tend to use NOT as often as we use AND or, because it is a very specific tool. Generally, you use NOT to eliminate results that pop up when two search terms often go together and you are only interested in one of them and want to eliminate the combinations of the two. So in this case, Cal Poly, not Pomona, is one way to ensure that you'll only get results dealing with Cal Poly Slow and Cal Poly Humboldt. Now, there are two basic ways you can use Boolean operators when you query a database. The first way is to place your keywords in separate search boxes and then select a Boolean operator from the drop-down boxes provided next to those search boxes in order to tell the database how to interpret the relationship between the search terms. When those drop-down menus aren't available, you can still tell the database to use Booleans by typing the operators between the search terms in all caps. The final tool that can be useful for you when searching a catalog or database are subject headings. What are subject headings, you ask? Subject headings are specialized descriptive terms that are attached to the items in a database. They do two basic things. First, they describe what that term is about, the topics it covers, the people involved, the methods used, etc. Second, they serve as hyperlinks between that item and every other item in the database that has that same heading. Now, not every database uses subject headings, and they don't all use the same system of descriptive terms, so we don't suggest that you start your research with a subject search, but they do have their uses. Assume for a moment that after multiple keyword searches, you've only found a few sources. What do you do? Well, you can go into the record for one of those sources and look at their subject headings. If you find one that is relevant to your research topic, you can click on it and see what else is in the database that shares that heading. Often you'll find materials you won't find from just a keyword search alone. So when all else fails, checking out the subject headings on one of your results may provide you with a rich, unique set of search results you wouldn't find in any other way. Finding information involves knowing which search tool to use and how to effectively query it. You do this by picking the tool, a website or database or repository, most likely to provide you with what you're looking for, using keywords as your search terms instead of just typing your question into the search box, using a variety of keywords and synonyms in different combinations to see what gives you the best results, when possible, using Boolean operators to help you make your searches more specific or efficient, and finally, if you're only finding a few sources, checking out the subject headings for those sources to see what else is out there. As this can be complicated, you can, as always, ask a librarian for assistance. We're happy to help you navigate the variety of information tools out there for you to use.